morning is John 2:13 through 22. It's on page 863 in your Bible, or you can follow along on the back of your bulletin. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and turned over their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume you." The Jews said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. And God add his blessing to this reading of his word.
What a troublesome little passage of scripture that is, you know? I mean, think about this. Gentle Jesus, meek and mild, loses it in the outer court of the Jewish temple. The temple. We're talking about the temple that had been around for 10 centuries before Jesus was even born, back in the time of King Solomon. And Jesus, what does he do? He makes his own whips, and he drives humans and animals out of the temple. And he turns over tables, and he scatters coins all over the place. And he goes on this rant about making his Father's house into a marketplace. Wait, that's not the only troubling thing about this scripture, too. One of the things that drives Bible scholars absolutely nuts is that here in the Gospel of John, John says that it's the beginning of Jesus' ministry. In other words, it's written, look, first two chapters. Chapter 2 is when this shows up. Matthew and Mark and Luke, the other stories of Jesus in the Gospels, they don't have it until way later at the end of his ministry, in the last week before he was crucified. So that really makes for a confusing story. But the ridiculous thing is there are some people who want to kind of make the Gospel all make sense. Biblical narratives will say, well, clearly, Jesus cleansed the temple twice. Once at the beginning of his ministry and once at the end. Matthew, Mark, and Luke just forgot about the beginning one, and John just forgot about the last one. Pardon me if I just dismiss that, because for me, I would much rather concentrate on the why instead of the when. So why? Why did Jesus make such a big scene in the temple? Well, he didn't like what he saw. There were merchants there selling animals for sacrifice. Good grief, what's that all about? Well, the thing is that was not unusual at all. There was nothing new about selling animals in the temple. And this is a big revelation for me as I was reading commentaries on this, because listen, I've preached the sermon about all those greedy, awful money changers in the temple and how they were just, what are they doing there? Well, the thing is they were there because what are people going to do who aren't ranchers or farmers or anything like that? Where are they going to get their animals for sacrifice, right? Where are they going to get them? So here's Jesus flying off the handle about something that made it possible for people to practice their religion. So then there must have been something else going on here. And you're in luck because John, of those four gospel writers, explains it best. He may not add up as far as the timeline goes, but he really explains it well. Now remember, the Gospels were not the first books written in the New Testament, right? Can anybody remember what the first books that were written in the New Testament as far as where they sit on the timeline? Pardon? The epistles, right. So those letters that Paul wrote to the churches that we kind of find in the middle of the Bible were actually the first ones written. And they were written somewhere in the neighborhood of 50 to 57 in what we call common area, AD. Matthew, Mark, and Luke came around somewhere between the 70s and the 90s, and John's Gospel was a late one. It came around somewhere between 90 and 110. Now, this is significant because something really tragic happened in the year 70, which is between the time that the epistles were written and the Gospels were written. What happened was the Romans were getting really tired of all these little factions of Jewish sects kind of rising up and challenging them and things like that. So what they did is they sent an army down to Jerusalem, laid siege to Jerusalem, and leveled that temple. Just took it down, down to the stones. And so it's no surprise that the gospel writers wanted to emphasize Jesus's cleansing of the temple. Because see, after the temple was destroyed, all of the Jews were thinking, oh my word, what are we going to do? What are we going to do without this temple? Because that is the center of our worship. That's where we fulfill our sacrifices and our obligations to do that. That's where God lives. Because that's what they believe. This is where God lives in the Holy of Holies. But Jesus' message, especially here in John's Gospel, is you don't need a temple to worship God. Because I am the temple. Oh, okay, well, I get it. The early church, who was mostly made up of Jews, needed to hear this. And that's probably why it's one of the events that all four gospel writers highlight. So this is definitely a source of comfort to those early Christians who are probably feeling pretty hopeless because that central place of worship of theirs had been destroyed. So, I guess today what we can compare it to is, what if the Vatican were leveled? What if somebody bombed the Vatican? What if somebody took up the big temple in Salt Lake City for the Mormons? Or, heaven forbid, what if somebody took down our general offices in Indianapolis? We would feel lost, wouldn't we? We'd feel that there was something that we have done that has caused this. It would be devastating. And we need to be reminded that because of Jesus, we don't need these buildings made out of stone to be in relationship with God. So now you can kind of get an idea and a picture of why this was such an important event. Okay, well then thank you very much, Jesse, for the history lesson, but you still haven't explained why. Why did Jesus get so angry over this? Why would somebody whose life and ministry seemed to center around peace and nonviolence just threaten people and destroy property in a temple? Has anyone ever told you to not be angry? Has anybody ever told you that it's bad to be angry? You know, because sometimes we hear it from parents and teachers and friends or employees or employers or others who have influence in our life or that we work with. Don't be angry. Can't you be nice? Have you ever heard anyone say it's better to be nice than to show anger? See, anger isn't the problem. The why, the how, and the where about the way we direct our anger, that's the problem. I know people, and you do too, who fly off the handle at every little thing, right? To the point where they do it so often that other people don't even listen to them anymore. You know folks like that? I got to tell you the story. There was some faculty members at the seminary that I went to. They've died, so I can tell the story and use names. So Dr. Fred Morris was a professor of theology at Emmanuel School of Religion, and that man was born fighting and continued to fight throughout his life. If someone came up with something that he didn't agree with, he would stand up, yell, rant, rave, pace, interrupt people, and generally derail a meeting in no time flat. These are faculty meetings that they're having. And then, you know, he got to the point where all the other faculty members just quit listening to him. Even if he had a good point, they would just roll their eyes, oh boy, here goes Fred again, he's going to go off the handle. But then on the other side of the room was Rex Jones. And Rex Jones was the director of practical ministries, and he hardly said anything. He would sit through a faculty meeting and not say a thing. Now, if there was something he agreed with, he'd vote yes. If there was something he disagreed with, he would vote no. Now, on the occasion that Rex actually spoke up about something, what do you think people would do? It'd be like E.F. Hutton. Remember those E.F. Hutton commercials? When E.F. Hutton speaks, people listen. So when Rex would say something, they thought, oh, wow, this must be really important. And then, on those rare occasions that Rex would get angry, when that happened, everyone turned their attention to him, because if this was something that upset Rex to the point of anger, it must be seriously a matter of justice. And typically, the room came to a consensus that if Rex believed in something that strongly, he must have actually taken the time to think about this, think it through. He must have taken the time to actually pray about this issue in order to come to his conclusion. And in these cases, the way Rex voted was usually the way the rest of the faculty voted, even Dr. Norris. Now, think about all the times in our history when anger, especially as it relates to injustice, has inspired great change and reform. You've got women's suffrage, temperance, the civil rights movement, apartheid, the Stonewall movement, Black Lives Matter, hashtag MeToo, the moral majority, disability rights, farm workers, Mothers Against Drunk Driving, Just Say No, the Tea Party, the Occupy movements, Moral Mondays, too many to name. Some of these movements were started by mild-mannered people whose anger over injustice motivated them to fight for change. So had the leaders of these movements given in to the temptation to be nice? Who knows what would have happened? Or who knows what wouldn't have happened? See, their anger at whatever injustice they saw is what motivated them to act. We've heard the term righteous anger, but I'm not sure what to think about that label. Because again, there are people who think that their angry response to every little thing that bothers them is righteous anger. But I like Paul's admonition to the Ephesian church in Ephesians 4:26. He says, "Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil." So, Jesus' anger in the temple wasn't necessarily directed at the money changers. It was directed more towards the broken system that caused people to believe that they had to rely on human-made structures that required merchants and money changers in order to feel connected to God. See, the temple was just a tool. It was just a place made out of stone. It wasn't a bad place. At least it wasn't necessary in order for people to experience God's presence. You know, it wasn't necessary at all. And sometimes we get hung up on things, buildings, paintings, statues, banners, stained glass, whatever, and we forget that the church is not a place. A church is the people. And that's what Jesus was trying to teach when he got so mad in the temple. You don't need this place. It's the people, not the building, that matters. We are God's people. Structures, they're temporary. Buildings, they come and go. Now, Graham and I went down to Livermore on Friday to pick up, I can show you them now. Thanks for reminding me, Gary. Check this out. They're comfy. You can sort of kind of rock in it too. They got armrests. First service was really concerned because they were afraid they were going to go to sleep, you know, because this armrest kind of holds them up and things. But this is what we went down to Livermore, and we put a lot of them in the chapel because those chairs in the chapel were getting a lot of wear and tear, and they're fading and all sorts of things going on with them. But we had to do this. We had to go down there and get those chairs because United Christian Church in Livermore could no longer afford to maintain their building. And what's interesting is that the building was originally a Jewish synagogue. And the synagogue wasn't able to afford to maintain that building, so they sold it to United Christian Church. Now, we had their chairs now because they have to take everything out of that building so they can bulldoze it. That's good. That was the response that the first service had, too. You just played right into me. Thank you. See, think about that. Think about that reaction. In the long run, here's why they're doing it. Because in the long run, it's going to be more economical for them to sell the lot than to spend the money that it would take to fix the building. So, you know, can you imagine how those people at United might be feeling right now? I mean, I got some gasps and groans out of you. Think about those poor people at United Church, Christian Church. Now, can you imagine how the folks from the synagogue must have felt when they had to sell the building, or what they might be feeling now, knowing that this building that they spent so much time and effort and resources to construct is going to be leveled? Some of them might even be angry over this, right? They might be angry. They might be finger pointing and blaming and things like that. I don't know. I really don't know. I hope not. I really hope not. Because that kind of anger seems like a waste of time and energy that is better spent on building community. Now that's the kind of building that the church should be invested in. Because when you build community, you're not as likely to fixate on things that are made of wood or stone or metal. When you build community, you're more likely to focus on people and what sort of injustices might be occurring in their lives that hinders or prevents them from being in relationship with God or the community of God's people. You might even feel angry about the powers and principalities at work that keep people from being in those relationships too. But you know what? That's okay. Good things can come out of that sort of anger. Not so much when the anger is over things that will only tarnish or rust